بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا وأنت يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا All praise is due to Allah and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let us first have the proper intention in our hearts to attend the lesson for the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have chosen to talk about the most important rules relating to fasting, as many questions might arise about this topic, and inshallah ta'ala will explain most of these rules pertaining to fasting. Fasting the month of Ramadan is an obligation, and it is one of the most important matters of Islam. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, "Buniya al-Islamu ala khams, shahadati an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan rasulullah wa iqami as-salah wa ita'i az-zakah wa hajj al-bayt wa sawmi Ramadan." So he mentioned five important matters that Islam is based on: the two testifications of faith, praying, fasting, paying zakah, and performing pilgrimage. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam counted fasting the month of Ramadan amongst these important matters of Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ Meaning, all you who believe, fasting has been ordained as an obligation upon you, as it was ordained upon the previous nations, so you may become pious. So fasting helps one become pious. And that shows that fasting is not something specific for this nation. Rather, the previous nations used to fast. Same fast as we do, from dawn till sunset, abstaining from eating and drinking and the rest of the invalidators of fasting. However, what is specific about this nation is fasting the month of Ramadan. So Allah Azza wa Jal specified this nation with fasting the month of Ramadan. And Ramadan is the best month. Out of all the lunar months of the year, Ramadan is the best month. In it, the Quran was sent down by its entirety from the guarded tablet to the first sky, to a place called Baytul Izzah. In it, the Torah was sent down. In it, the Zabur was sent down, and the Injil was sent down. So these heavenly books, holy books, were sent down during the month of Ramadan. Ramadan contains the night of Al-Qadr. That's when these books were sent down. And the night of Al-Qadr is the best night out of all the nights of the year. So Ramadan is a very special month filled with blessings. And the month of Ramadan is a month of multiplication of reward. So the rewards will be multiplied during the month of Ramadan. So it is an opportunity for one to purify himself, by not only abstaining from food and drink, by abstaining from the prohibitions, by repenting to Allah Azza wa Jal. Ramadan is an opportunity for one to repent. It's the month of repentance, it's the month of mercy, it's the month of tranquility, the month of the multiplication of reward, and so on. So this is a month that every Muslim, pious Muslim around the world awaits. The pious Muslims long for the month of Ramadan, and they wait for it, and they count the days till it comes, because they know that this is the opportunity for them where they can receive more rewards. Subhanallah, the people of the dunya, yani those who seek worldly pleasures, some of them might be waiting for the month of Ramadan so they can sell more of their products, they can make more money. But the pious Muslim doesn't look at this. He looks at the rewards he might earn during this month due to the multiplication of reward. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to fast a lot. And when Our Lady Aisha radiallahu anha, the wife of the Prophet, was asked about the pattern of fasting of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, meaning how often he used to fast, and this is other than the month of Ramadan, she said he used to fast to an extent that we would say he never break his fast. And he used not to fast to an extent that we could realize him not fasting. Meaning the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to fast many days during the year. Then she continued by saying, and he used to fast of Sha'ban more than any other month. Sha'ban, which is the month coming. And I've never witnessed him fasting a full month except for the month of Ramadan. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to fast Mondays and Thursdays. And when he was asked about the reason behind this, he said, and why the Prophet is eager to fast every Monday and Thursday? He said, on these 2 days, the deeds will be raised. And I want my deeds to be raised while I'm fasting. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very keen to fast as many days as he can during the year. He used to fast of Sha'ban more than any other month, and he used to fast the whole month of Ramadan. So it is a great opportunity for one in Ramadan to rectify himself. He would look at himself, evaluate himself, what he's doing, and he would look forward to better himself during the month of Ramadan. What happens during the month of Ramadan? Great things happen. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when the month of Ramadan commences, the doors of paradise will be widely open, and the doors of hellfire will be closed. And the senior devils will be chained. So that's an opportunity. If the doors of paradise are open, the doors of hellfire are closed, and the senior devils are chained. So this is to help the Muslim perform more good deeds during this month. So you shouldn't show laziness during the month of Ramadan. Rather, you should be more active. You should be more active. And subhanAllah, when you get used to fasting, you find yourself able to achieve many things even when you are fasting. A lesson we learn from the companions to put more effort when we are fasting. So Ramadan is an opportunity. However, one has to be cautious. One has to give attention to the rules of fasting in order to make sure that he's fasting properly and his fast is valid and accepted by Allah. Otherwise, he will be abstaining from eating and drinking for the whole day, and he wouldn't get the rewards he's looking at the end of the day. And that's the meaning of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he said, a person may fast and he doesn't get from his fasting except that he became hungry and thirsty. And a person may stay all night awake praying and he doesn't get from his awakeness all night except that he was tired and sleepy all night because he didn't sleep. So why would that be the case? Because maybe he's doing something that invalidates his acts of worship. So he won't get from these acts of worship the reward he's looking at because his acts of worship are not valid. So that's why when you want to do something in Islam, you need to learn about it to make sure that you are doing it properly. Otherwise, you might do it incorrectly while assuming you are performing this act of worship in the right way. Now, some ignorant people say, isn't it the intention enough for one to have a good intention that he wants to practice religion? Isn't it that enough? No, that's not enough. Because Al-Bukhari narrated that a man came to the Prophet's mosque, prayed, then he came to the Prophet to greet him. The Prophet said to him, go back and pray because you haven't prayed. So he went back, he did the same. Then he came back to the Prophet. The Prophet said the same, go back and pray because you haven't prayed. Then, meaning you haven't prayed, a valid prayer, a correct prayer. So he went for the third time and did the same. So he didn't correct his mistake that he's doing. So he kept on repeating the same mistake. So the Prophet realized that this person is unaware of the rules of prayer, how to pray properly. So it's not something he was overlooking out of forgetfulness and the like. Then when he came the third time, the Prophet said, go back and pray because you haven't prayed. Then he said, O Messenger of Allah, I swear by Allah who sent you truly to us that I don't know how to pray except what you have seen me doing. The Prophet didn't say to him, why did you come to the mosque? Didn't you come to the mosque with the intention of praying? Wasn't your intention is to pray? Allah will accept from you. No, he didn't say this. Rather, the Prophet taught him how to pray from the beginning till the end. If you want to be a doctor and make open heart surgeries, would you just go to a person, let us say your neighbor is sick with heart problems? Now, would you dare to go to him and say, look, I want to help you. I want to do this surgery for you. I want to save you some thousands. I want to open your heart, try to fix it. You won't do this because you don't have any knowledge about this. When it comes to flying a plane, would you fly a plane if you don't know how to fly it? No. Would you jump into the sea if you don't know how to swim? You don't do this. So why in worldly matters, people say, no, I don't know how to do it. I have to learn first. But when it comes to the religious practices, you find them just going, indulging in these acts of worship while being ignorant about the rules. This is happening these days. You find someone who is praying, but if you listen to his recitation, he doesn't recite the Fatiha properly. And the Prophet said, the prayer is invalid without proper recitation of Fatiha. So if one doesn't recite the Fatiha properly, his prayer is invalid. So the intention is not enough. The intention is important. It is important to have a good intention that you're doing it for the sake of Allah, to get rewards from Allah. Also, intention is an integral of fasting as well as integral of prayer. However, you need to fulfill the other integrals as well, not only one thing. All the integrals must be fulfilled. You know, the prayer has 17 integrals. 17. If you do not fulfill the 17 integrals, your prayer is invalid. So when one is unaware of these 17 integrals, how would he know that he is praying properly? It's not just to stand, put the prayer mat, say Allahu Akbar, then you do mistakes in the prayer and you don't pray properly. It's not like this. You have to learn how to pray properly so you can perform the prayer properly so your prayer will be valid. Otherwise, you might think you are practicing your religion when in fact you are doing incorrect acts of worship and they won't be accepted from you. So your intention won't suffice in that case, won't be enough in that case. You have to learn how to perform the prayer, how to fast, what amount of money you have to pay as zakah. People are not giving enough attention to the religious practices, but they give a lot of attention to what? To the worldly things where they can get money, materialistic benefit that will perish eventually. And when one dies, they take him to the grave with the shroud only, and the shroud doesn't have even pockets. So he won't be taken $1 with him. All his money that he gathered in this life will be left behind, and he's gonna be by himself. Think about this moment. That's scary, to be honest. Every time a Muslim would think thoroughly about this moment, when I'm going to go to the grave, I'm gonna be by myself, and they bury me in the grave, and they put the soil on top, they cover the grave, I'm by myself in this darkness. So what would benefit me when I'm alone in that place? The good deeds that you have performed properly and were accepted by Allah Azza wa Jal. So you need to prepare yourself for the grave, because you know you are going to go to the grave. But if you are building a house, you might finish building the house and you won't have any chance to live in it, and you die before that. And it happened. There are many examples about this. Maybe you've heard some stories about someone who was preparing himself to get married, and then he died before getting married. I went once to a funeral gathering for a young man, and that they call it the third day, where they gather on the third day. And subhanAllah, the father looked at me and he said, you know, this day, that was supposed to be his wedding day. So they booked that day as his wedding day, but it turned up to be what? The third day from his death. So that's why this life, the worldly matters are not guaranteed. You might be looking at something, but you might not get it, simply because you don't know what's going to happen after 1 minute. But if you are working for the hereafter, you are praying, you are fasting, you are performing the obligations, and you make sure you are not missing out any of the obligatory prayers, you make sure you're not missing out any of the days of fasting without an excuse. So to a certain extent, you are ready, to a certain extent. So you know, when you die, that's it. I have, alhamdulillah, I know myself, I was regular on praying, fasting, these obligations, and the sins, most of the sins I'm avoiding. So that's why you hope for the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be bestowed upon you. But if you know yourself, you're missing out some of the obligatory prayers, you're missing out some of the days of fasting, you commit sins every day, think about this moment. Think about this moment and don't say, I'm still young. You've heard recently, how many young people died recently? In a motorbike accident, in a car accident, things like this. So that's why it's not guaranteed. It's not guaranteed for you to live until you become old. And that's when you think, yeah, at that age, I'll start fixing myself, rectifying myself, performing good deeds. Yeah, you might not be able to. It happened once, there was a person who never used to pray. And subhanAllah, when we mention this as an example, it could happen. That person never used to pray. They said to him, why don't you pray? Start praying, fear Allah Azza wa Jal. You don't know what could happen to you. And Ramadan was coming soon in that year. So he said, inshaAllah, when Ramadan commences, I'll pray and fast. Then they kept on telling him, start praying from now. Don't wait till Ramadan. Start from now praying. And subhanAllah, do you know when did he die? He died on the first night of Ramadan. So he didn't fast any of the days of Ramadan and he didn't pray. Like when they say Ramadan is tomorrow, that's the first day, he died on the night before. So you have to make sure that you are obeying your Lord as Allah ordered you. Not as you think is right, as Allah ordered you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, مَنْ تَوَضَّأَ كَمَا أُمِرْ وَصَلَّى كَمَا أُمِرْ غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ. Whoever performs wudu as ordered and prays as ordered, then his minor sins will be forgiven. See, that word as ordered, meaning it's not up to you how to pray. No, you need to follow the rules. You need to make sure this is the way I have to pray and this is the way the prayer will be valid. You're worried about your health. Have you ever asked yourself, what about my recitation of the Fatiha? Am I reciting the Fatiha properly? I want to go to a sheikh who is a good reciter to see if my Fatiha is recited properly in the prayer. Then you go to another one to double check, to see if your recitation is correct. Who is doing this? Only when it comes to your health, you are worried. When it comes to your money, you are worried. Why? What takes you to paradise, religion or money? Religion. Your health will deteriorate in the end. You know yourself, you're not gonna be the same. So you expect your health to be worse, not to be better in most cases. So don't worry about your health. Rely on Allah Azza wa Jal. If you really have a problem, you go to the doctor, try to get treated. That's something normal you do. But what about the acts of worship? Are you performing these acts of worship in a valid manner, in a proper way? You need to think about this. So that's why you need to assign time, commit yourself to lessons where you go and learn about the rules of the acts of worship to make sure you are doing the act of worship as you are ordered. Not as you thought it's okay or it is correct, as you are ordered. Keep that in mind. So that's why now inshallah Azza wa Jal to benefit for those who have acquired the rules of fasting before, they will be revising and refreshing their memory about these rules, and some new rules may be introduced to them as well. And for those who haven't acquired these rules, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to have a series of sessions every Wednesday to finish before Ramadan, inshallah, the important rules of fasting. First of all, we'll talk about how do we determine the beginning of the month of Ramadan. Definitely you would say, yeah, I believe it's not a matter of opinion. And it's not by voting. There are people who are doing it. They vote for Ramadan. Who told you Ramadan is a candidate for you to vote for and to determine which day you want Ramadan to start? It's not up to you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us clear instructions, explicit and clear instructions. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Sumu li ru'yatihi wa aftiru li ru'yatihi fa in ghumma alaykum fa akmilu 'iddata sha'ban 30." Very explicit and very clear. It means commence your fast when you see the crescent of the new moon. End your fast when you see the crescent of the new moon. If you were blocked from seeing it, then count 30 days of Sha'ban, then start fasting. What do they need clearer than these instructions and more explicit? The Prophet is telling us about a method that we should follow in order to know when to commence fasting and when to end fasting. Because every lunar month is either 29 or 30 days. The lunar month doesn't come 31 days, and the lunar month doesn't come 28 days. It's either 29 or 30. So you expect yourself every year to fast either 29 days or 30 days. And this is based on what? Based on what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. That on the 29th day of Sha'ban, after sunset, and this is what Muslims do around the world, the majority, they watch the western horizon where the sun sets. Because the moon, if it were to be seen, it will be seen exactly in the west. So where the sun sets, where the sun sets, you might be able to see the moon for a period of time, short period of time, within half an hour from sunset, you might be able to see it. If you see that crescent, which is very thin line, if you see it, that means the following day is the first day of Ramadan. If you don't see it, that means the following day is the 30th of Sha'ban, and then definitely the day after will be the first day of Ramadan, because the month can be maximum of how many days? 30. So once you have 30 days of Sha'ban, and that's what the Prophet said. If you see the crescent, start fasting. If you don't see it, count 30 days of Sha'ban and start fasting, because that's the maximum a lunar month can be. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam instructed us to do. This hadith is narrated in different versions by Bukhari, Muslim, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Abu Dawood, An-Nasa'i, Ahmad ibn Hanbal. The narrators of hadith in the books of hadith, when talking about Ramadan and how to determine the beginning of the month of Ramadan, they mentioned all these ahadith in that chapter. So they have actually chapters about how to determine the beginning of the month of Ramadan, and they list all these ahadith narrated from the Prophet, from different companions, that the Prophet was emphasizing the method of determining the beginning and the end of the month of Ramadan, and that is to see the crescent or to continue 30 days of the month. This is the only way. So when there is explicit text, which is from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then the scholar said, there is no way for one to give his opinion, even if he is a scholar. Why? Because there is explicit text. He cannot go against the explicit text. In the Quran, it is mentioned, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةُ وَالْدَّمُ وَلَحْمُ الْخِنْزِيرِ. Eating al-mayta, either dead non-edible animal, or edible animal that died without being slaughtered Islamically. This is called mayta. We cannot eat it. We cannot eat the flowing blood that comes out of the slaughtered animal. So even you can eat the flesh and the meat of the sheep, but when you slaughter it, see the blood that flows, gushes out of it, you cannot eat it. Al-khinzir, any meat or flesh or fat extracted from pigs, one is not allowed to eat. So these are explicit texts regarding these cases. So there is no one who is allowed to say, in my opinion, you can eat, for instance, ham or bacon or whatever, if you are at your university or if you are at your school. That's not an excuse. But unfortunately, there are some who unfortunately look like sheikhs, religious figures, and they give wrong fatwas about such judgments. Like one in Europe, he had a conference and they issued a statement at the end of the conference, and he said in it, you are allowed to eat any food product with pig extracts in it, like fat or flesh or whatever. He said, as long as the percentage of the pig extracts in it does not exceed 1%. What is that mentioned in the Quran? What is it mentioned in the hadith? In the Quran, it's explicit that you are not allowed to eat it. Now, unless the scholar said someone was in the desert and he was starving to death, and he couldn't find in front of him something to eat to make him survive except a dead pig, he can eat what would make him survive. That's something mentioned even in the Quran. That's in the case of necessity, when one is starving to death. But not when you go to the supermarket and you have many alternatives. You have many alternatives. Sometimes you don't find halal meat in a place. Some people you find them negligent and they go and buy non-halal meat. It's not slaughtered Islamically. They buy it and they eat it. Why? You know what some people say? Yeah, this is a case of necessity. What is a case of necessity? You can buy vegetables, you can buy fish. You have many alternatives to survive. And you're not gonna die if you don't eat this non-halal meat. But subhanAllah, you find many people negligent when it comes to these matters. So when there is an explicit text in the Quran or the Hadith, there is no way for ijtihad meaning deducing a judgment. When there is no explicit text, and this is the task of the mujtahid, the top scholars, not the carpenter and the bricklayer and someone, a teacher or whatever, no. Top scholars, those who have memorized all the verses of the rules, all the ahadith pertaining to rules, they know what is called Al-Aam wal-Khas, the general and the specific. And they know about the explicit and non-explicit. They know about all these rules that will qualify them to make ijtihad when there is no explicit text. But when there is an explicit text, there is no way for ijtihad. Otherwise, this religion will be lost. Just imagine now you hear about someone who said, no, in my opinion, you can eat pork and ham and all these products. He is going against the religion. Someone said in another area, let us say, you are allowed to commit fornication and adultery. They are coming up with things against the rules of the religion. And there are explicit texts regarding these matters. So there is no way for one To make ijtihad when there is explicit text, you need to understand this rule. Otherwise, our religion will be lost. So don't be tempted by how big the turban of this so-called sheikh is. If it's big, yeah, but have you seen his turban? It's so big. Why can't we take with his opinion? This is not the consideration in our religion. Then some people say, yeah, mashallah, he has a long beard. Yeah, who said if he has a long beard, that means that's it, whatever he says, you can take from him. That's not the consideration. Some said a verse of poetry, and they mentioned, according to the length of the beard, one will be appointed as a judge, then they would have brought the goat and appointed him as a judge. The goat has something long like a beard. That's not the consideration. In Islam, you don't take with these matters and you neglect the essentials. Is this person abiding by the rules of the religion or not? Some people are giving titles, big titles. Maybe in some areas they call him Mufti, they call him the president of whatever, the chairman of whatever, titles. Yeah, that doesn't make him qualified to give his own opinion about religion. That doesn't make him allowed to go against the religion, the Quran and the Sunnah. So, when you hear someone saying something to you, it's not rude to say to him, what's the proof about what you say? Give me a verse from the Quran. Give me a hadith of the Prophet that supports your claim. You're claiming such and such. Give me proof. Otherwise, would you go to the chemist and take any medicine from there? You won't do this. And you say, yeah, if the doctor says to you, yeah, I'll give you this medicine, you might say, what about any side effect for it? You ask about this. So if someone is giving you an Islamic judgment, don't you ask him, what are you getting it from? Even if he has turban and long beard, if he says, yeah, this is my opinion, you say to him, I can give my opinion as well. But I'm not asking you about your opinion. I'm asking you about the religious judgment. I need to know what is mentioned in the Quran because maybe I didn't read the whole Quran. I didn't read all the ahadith of the Prophet. Give me a proof. I don't want your opinion. What should I do with your opinion? So you don't take with his opinion. You need the rule about this matter according to the rules of the religion. What is mentioned about it? So when the Prophet said, commence your fast when you see the crescent. End your fast when you see the crescent. If it's cloudy and you are blocked from seeing the crescent, then counsel to days of Sha'ban. This is very explicit message from the Prophet. When to start fasting and when to break your fast. The scholars throughout 14 centuries, starting from the time of the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then the followers, the companions with the Prophet, then the followers of the companions, then the followers of the followers, so that's called as-salaf, the predecessors, then the successors, al-khalaf, throughout 14 centuries, 1,400 years, all the scholars in the past, all Muslim countries, used to follow this method. They send people to monitor, to observe the western horizon. If they see the crescent, they announce. And even they had some beautiful traditions. Like, you know, they started to proclaim the beginning of the month of Ramadan. They invented using the cannon. People will know that tomorrow is the first day of Ramadan. Also, they used to ignite fire on the tops of the mountains. On top of the mountains, so people can see these fires and they know tomorrow is the first day of Ramadan after they observe. Muslims throughout 14 centuries are on these matters, following the method of the Prophet, following these nice traditions. But unfortunately, some people these days who are looking for fame want people to leave aside all these ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to follow the calculations of the astronomers. Now, by consensus, that's according to Shafi'i school, Hanafi, Maliki and Hanbali, it's mentioned in their books that we are not allowed to rely on the calculations of the astronomers to determine the beginning and the end of the month. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he said once, we are a nation that do not rely on calculations to determine the beginning and the end of the month. The month is either 29 or 30 days. Do you need more explicit than this? This is narrated by Al-Bukhari and Ahmad and others. So explicit text from the Prophet. We are a nation that do not rely on calculations to determine the beginning and the end of the month. What does that mean? The astronomer, even in the past, they observe the phases of the moon. They calculate every day how much it's losing, whatever. You know, from a crescent to full moon, then back to a crescent, then it disappears. They calculate and they know as an estimate when is the birth of the new moon. That's what they can determine by their calculations. And now they have some softwares on the computer where they apply all the information, it calculates automatically. It tells them in the year 2017, the birth of the moon of Ramadan will be at this time. The birth of the moon, that's what they find in their calculations. The birth of the moon. The question is, does Ramadan start by the birth of the moon? The answer is not. It doesn't. The answer is, it doesn't start by the birth of the moon. Why? Because the birth of the moon could be during the day, at 10 o'clock in the morning. Does that mean it's now the birth of the new moon based on the calculations, I'll start my fast? You fast half a day? That's not the case. The birth of the new moon does not determine the beginning of the month. Otherwise, imagine now the month has started, 10 o'clock. It won't be 29 or 30 days as the Prophet mentioned. However, the consideration is, after the birth of the new moon, after sunset, if the moon is seen, then the following day is the beginning of the month. If it's not seen, then they continue the following day as the 30th of the month, then the day after will be the beginning of the new month. This is how it is, very simple. Now, look at the rules of the religion. They are linked to simple methods, not complicated methods. Now, if I say to you, who knows about astronomy and the calculations of the new moon, put your hand up. No one will put his hand up. Okay, if I gather people, if I go to Mecca when they are performing Hajj, those who are experts in astronomy, put your hand up. Who's going to put his hand up? Only few, very rare you find who are able to make these calculations. Yeah, but the acts of worship are not linked with complicated methods. Simple methods. Any one of you can do it. After the sunset, watch the western horizon. If you see it, you know the following day is the beginning of the month. Abdullah ibn Umar, after sunset, he looked, he saw the crescent. But no one else saw the crescent. Abdullah ibn Umar, companion, trustworthy, he came to the Prophet. And he said to the Prophet, I testify that I saw the crescent of Ramadan. What did the Prophet do? He intended to fast the following day and he ordered the companions to fast. Based on what? The testimony of a trustworthy Muslim. How simple is that? How simple is that? Not to make calculations. Plus, when they make these calculations, and this is what's happening every year, they say, let us say, the birth of the new moon is at 10 o'clock in the morning, or 9 o'clock, or 6 o'clock, or whatever, then will the moon be sighted after sunset? of the 29th day of Sha'ban, then you find the astronomers having a dispute about this. Some say it could be seen in that region, for instance, in Africa, North Africa, West Africa, whatever it could be seen, but in South Asia it won't be seen, and this is based on the weather, if it is cloudy or it's clear. If I'm going to monitor the western horizon after the sunset of the 29th day of Sha'ban, that if I see the crescent, I start fasting the following day. If I don't see it, I count 30 days. If the astronomer put his head into these calculations, day and night making, then he said to me, possibly it could be seen, and maybe it won't be seen. That depends on the weather. What did I benefit from him? If he's telling me, yeah, maybe if the weather is clear, you might be able to see it. If it's not, you won't be able to see it. What did I benefit from you? What did I benefit from you? Nothing. Okay, a person might use astronomical calculations to make an estimated calendar for the whole year, an estimation for the whole year, but for each month he needs to observe to see that new crescent. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made it very clear. So those who say, now we shouldn't follow that traditional method, they call it, which is the method of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we should follow the astronomers, as if they are saying, go to the books of hadith, all these chapters about see fast when you see the crescent and end your fast when you see the crescent, cross them out because now they are expired. That's the meaning of it. Another thing, and this is happening every year, we told you they might have a dispute, the astronomers. What do they do sometimes? An astronomer would say, no, it won't be seen in Australia. Another astronomer would say, no, there is big chance it will be seen. So according to my findings, Ramadan will be on Tuesday. The other one would say, based on my findings, Ramadan will start on Monday. This happens every year. So even those who say, yeah, we need to unite Muslims, that's why we want to follow the astronomers. Yeah, but the astronomers are not united. What do you expect if the astronomers themselves are not united? How could you seek unity from what? From the dispute between these people. You cannot get it from them. Plus, you need to unite Muslims, unite them on something proper, accepted. And to say, yeah, we want all people to fast on the same day and all people to break the fast on the same day. That's not a problem. So now you prayed Isha. Does it mean in Lebanon they have to pray Isha? No, they don't pray Isha in Lebanon now. They pray in Asr maybe. It's not Isha time for them. So when you fast here, start your fast based on the crescent. And here, there in Lebanon, they don't start fast based on their own observation. What is the problem in that? Muslims lived for 14 centuries as strong, as power, undefeated power, and they never used to fast on the same day and break the fast on the same day. But now, because many Muslims left following and adhering to the methodology of the Prophet, that's when you found the weakness in this nation, unfortunately. So the weakness in leaving out the methodology of the Prophet, the strength in adhering to the methodology of the Prophet. It's not by, yeah, they say, but technology, you know, now technology is so advanced, so we need to follow technology. Yeah, technology does not nullify the rules of the religion. That's something you need to keep in mind. You know, in religion, if a lady gets divorced and she's not pregnant, what does she have to do? She has to wait for 3 non-menstrual periods, which is about 3 months, before she can remarry. That's the Islamic judgment. And this is from the time of the Prophet. Now, can someone say, yeah, but now in technology, they have the pregnancy test, they have all these blood tests, the pregnancy test, she can make a test. If she doesn't find herself pregnant, she can remarry straight away? No, this is an act of worship. So same, a person cannot say, I want to use technology, but they want to nullify the rules of the religion. No. You know how the scholars deduce the judgment from the books of the religion, from the verses, from the ahadith of the Prophet? You find them very smart. Those top scholars, when they deduce the judgment, this ayah refers to such and such and this hadith, but if we take the other hadith into consideration, if we put them together, you find them very, very clever, like Imam Shafi'i and Malik and Ahmad and Abu Hanifa, very clever to deduce the judgment. Someone who is not even a knowledgeable person, but he wears the costume of the sheikhs. He wanted to follow the astronomers and he wanted to make what he called ijtihad. Now we know how the scholars make ijtihad. Then he said, according to his claim, he said, I found proof that we can follow the astronomers and not follow the traditional method. Can you imagine of so-called Shaykh, what type of proof, evidence he deduced? He said, he didn't say from the Quran or Hadith, whatever, he said, you know, people now use sprinklers for making istinja in the toilet. And that sprinkler, now they connect it to the tap and they make istinja with it. This wasn't at the time of the Prophet. He said, now they are using sprinkler for making istinja. Same, we can use astronomy to determine the beginning of the month and the end of it. Wow. This person, like, where do you hear such a thing? Maybe in some mental hospitals, you might hear such a type of so-called deduction. When someone is linking this to that, this is not the rule of the religion. So Islamically, to be safe, you follow this way. But to make it easier, many scholars said, if the crescent is seen on any part of the earth, then the rest of the countries who know about this would follow them and start the fast on that same day. That's a solution. How many moons are there for the earth?
One
moon. So there is one moon. If you don't see it here, they might see it in Canada, they might see it in Brazil, they might see it in Lebanon, they might see it in Pakistan. It's one moon. It's very simple. You can't follow your country of origin. Yeah, because now they are praying Zuhr, not Isha. So you don't follow their time zone and you follow them in that. There is only one moon. If it is seen on any part of the earth, then the rest of the countries should follow. And this is the saying of most of the scholars. So this is the only way that the beginning of the month of Ramadan and the end of it can be determined. Now the scholar said, because Ramadan is a month that you await for, trustworthy of one person is sufficient. The testimony of one trustworthy person is sufficient. But for other months, they have to be at least two. But Ramadan, everyone is keen to start this blessed month. So the testimony of one trustworthy person is sufficient for the month of Ramadan. When they see the crescent, it will be announced. This is the method they should follow. So always adhere to the methodology of the Prophet and you will succeed. And Allah knows best. We say La ilaha illallah 3 times.